Hello, my friends. How are you today? We are here on Sewing in Slippers with Sue to talk to you about fusible rotary cut applique and all of the different ways we can use applique in our gorgeous quilts. So I love applique, and my passion, my goal in life is to share applique with as many people as possible. Now, many of you have been turned off to applique. Maybe you've tried it once or twice and it seemed really tedious and really hard. Well, I love to show you a faster, easier way to applique. So come along with me into my studio and you will see how I use applique in my daily life as a quilter. When we're here, we're spending an hour together to talk about what projects I am working on, and maybe those will inspire you to get started with an applique project of your own. Today, I'm going to be sharing with you a few different things. First of all, we're going to be talking about a pattern that I created where all of the proceeds are going to charity. So that's number one on my list. Number two is I'm getting my students ready for a class in applique after quilting. So I want to talk to my students for just a minute about getting their background fabrics ready for that January workshop. And quilters in general have lots of UFOs. Now I'm saying in general because you might be one of those people that finishes everything you start. But if you're not, we're going to have some fun with UFOs. And I'm going to be kicking off a UFO challenge that I have for my students. Now, the last thing that we're going to do is we're going to be talking about sewing in slippers next week when we have a special guest. So let me just check. Okay, good. Sorry. I have a new iPhone watch and I don't know how to use it. And so without my phone here, I don't think I can turn off notifications. So I have to apologize if you hear it ding from time to time when somebody messages me or emails me. I'm going to ignore it for the next hour, but just letting you know, if you hear that ding, I promise you, I will figure out the technology and make sure that I get that turned off for the next Sewing in Slippers. So turn off notifications. You will see me writing some notes down below, and that notifications. Those will help me to make my program run more smoothly the next time. So first of all, let me tell you a little bit about me. I love to teach applique, and I used to travel around the country visiting quilt shows, quilt guilds, and lecturing, doing workshops, and vending at these various avenues in order to bring new people into my applique world. And I love sharing an easier way to applique with all of you. Now that I'm a home-based business, since COVID, I've been working from home and I love to teach online. So we have a fabulous group of quilters that are meeting online monthly in order to learn my rotary cut applique skills and to apply those to the quilts that they want to make. So we have a group making this quilt behind me. We have a group that makes smaller projects every month. There's a whole lot of groups going on. And if you're interested in finding out how to get involved with all of this, we are running a program this week called Applique School. In order to register for Applique School, and we just upped our limit. We had 500 limit initially in Applique School, and now we're up to 1,000 people that we can accept into Applique School. So it is limited seating, but we do have capacity right now. You can sign up for Applique School by going to my website, SuePellandDesigns.com. And Jen, could you put SuePellandDesigns.com out there in the comments? So Jennifer is a friend of mine that works with me, and I'm asking her, because I see her right here on the comments, I'm asking her to put that website in the comments so that you can get out there and sign up for Applique School. Okay, we have over 800 people signed up for Applique School right now. We can accept up to 1,000, so keep putting in your, submit your, what do you want to call it? It's not an application, your submission form. Just submit your name and email address so you can get notified of the Zoom link for Applique School, and that's happening Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday from 4 o'clock till 5, 5:30, 6 o'clock maybe if there's a lot of questions. 4 to 5 is going to be the lecture portion of applique school. And then from 5 on, we will do Q&A. And I'll be talking about all of the different programs from 5 and beyond. So the applique portion is going to be for an hour. Then stick around if you have questions, you want more information, or you want to know about working with me. All right, super. Jen, that's great. Thank you so much for putting the website in the comments. Okay, so my mantra, I would say, my mission statement, not exactly, but my mantra as I am doing my tasks every day for my job is I want to make a difference while I make a living, right? So this is my full-time job. I teach quilting full-time, and I have a staff of 3 other people that help me build this community and have this fabulous applique program that I offer online. So we want to make a difference in your life. We want to make a difference to quilters. We want to make a difference in the world at large while we make a living, right? So I'm employing these people. I'm employing myself. And at the same time, I don't just want to teach quilting. I want to make a difference in the world and in your life. So I know I can make a difference in your life by teaching you a better way to applique. But how can that translate into making the world a better place? I struggle with that because that is a huge goal of mine in general, right? And I can do that outside of my business. But how do I bring that into my business? So I had a little brainstorm last Monday, 1 week ago yesterday. I had a little brainstorm. I've been working with a local group that is raising money for an orphanage in Uganda. If you're interested in the orphanage, you can go to their website. It's New Life Ministries. Jen, could you type in New Life Ministries and actually find their website and put their website up on the comments? That way people will know what charity I'm raising money for. So it's New Life Ministries, and they are supporting an orphanage in Uganda that has 30 kids in the orphanage and one widow who helps take care of all of those kids. They don't have a great facility. This is a brand new orphanage that sprung up over COVID. Two gentlemen were out there doing outreach, doing their Christian ministry. They're doing outreach in the small town in Uganda, and they came across a whole bunch of orphans. And while their ministry was to serve the widows in the community, when they saw all of these orphans, they realized that they had a bigger job to do. So they opened an orphanage to house these 30 kids that they found living in the streets in this small town, and they hired one of the widows to help take care of them. They have a very, very small budget. It's about $800 a month to feed these kids and about $4,000, I don't know if it's a per quarter or per semester, in order to put these kids through school. Once they get to school, they get 2 meals a day. So that's why it's so important that we help put these kids into a school situation where they're being properly fed, and then helping the orphanage put a roof over their heads. So that's become part of my mission, where I can make a difference in the world. Now, how does that relate to my business? Well, it didn't until last Monday. I was working on yard sales and other types of fundraisers for this organization. And I said, you know what, Sue, what are you good at? You're good at writing patterns. So let's go ahead and write a pattern and support these kids. So I wrote the pattern that you see up there on the wall. It's the Scrappy Happy Temperature Quilt. Many of you know that I've been making a temperature quilt over the past year. I am, oh my gosh, maybe 3/4 done with my temperature quilt. I'm a little bit behind, but I'm working on getting caught up. And that temperature quilt was so much fun to make. And I started a Facebook group where people could share their temperature quilt ideas. And Beth Helfter shared this quilt with me that I fell in love with. Now, she did use my Hearts and More tools to cut out the circles for her quilt, and I asked her if I could use her inspiration of making that beautiful quilt and make it into a pattern. Now, it's been done before. It's not the most unique pattern in the world, but the pattern is a pattern plus. It has all kinds of information in there about how to make a temperature quilt, how to find your temperatures, how to record those temperatures, and keep a nice checklist of all the blocks that you've got made. So it's a pattern plus. It's available on my website, and all of the proceeds for the month of January are going to the New Life Ministries in Uganda. So my goal is to sell 100 patterns in January. Now, I'd love to blow that goal out of the water. We are already up to 50 patterns. We're halfway to our goal. We have raised over $1,000 for New Life Ministries, and I want to keep that going. So please share this Facebook Live. Tag somebody that you think might be interested in supporting this this effort to support the kids. You can grab your pattern, you can tag somebody else in the posts about the pattern, and you can help spread the word. Let this go viral. Maybe I'm going to sell 500 patterns in the month of January. Wouldn't that be spectacular? But my goal of 100, we're halfway there. So I want to share with you a little bit today about how I'm getting my fabrics ready for that pattern, because you might think, it's a little bit late to get started on a temperature quilt. Well, you know what? It really isn't. We're only a week into January, and you can get caught up so easy. This is such a fast and easy quilt. In fact, if you started on February 1st, you'd be able to catch up in just a couple of hours. The main amount of work in this quilt is getting your fabrics organized. So that's one thing I'm going to talk about today, is getting your fabrics organized. So I want to start with that. But the other thing that I want to talk about today is UFOs. What if you don't want to start a new project because you have so many UFOs? So I just want a little tongue in cheek here, just for some fun. I want you to put some words in the comments that are other names for UFOs. I know I've heard them all, but maybe you haven't. Personally, I like pigs. Pigs. What are pigs? Projects in grocery sacks. I just think that's the cutest name for a UFO. I got lots of pigs out there. So I'd love to hear all of your names for works in progress, UFOs, projects in grocery sacks. Let me know what you call your UFOs. I would love to generate a list of all of the different UFO names. And that ties right into my UFO challenge for my members. Members of my community Ahead of the Curve are going to be, I'm going to let them know about a UFO challenge after applique school. I'm a little up to my ears in applique school right now. But right afterwards, I'm going to let you know about how to get into the UFO challenge if you are a member of Ahead of the Curve. Now, if you're not a member of Ahead of the Curve and you want to learn more about that, that's what that hour is after applique school. So you can learn more about the programs that I offer and how you can get involved in rotary cut applique, and especially Ahead of the Curve membership, which is my favorite part of our community. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about that charity pattern and how we're going to get organized. And to do that, I'm going to share a different camera with you. Now, let me remember how to do that every single app that I use is different on how you set up your camera. So I just want to, oh my goodness, I wanted to take a moment to look at that camera, but I don't want to waste your time. So let me just check one more thing. Extra camera. Nope. Okay. So I'm not seeing changing my camera here, so I'm not going to worry about it just yet. All right, so I want to show you how I'm going to get organized for my temperature quilt. So what I have here are some plastic bags. All I did was I took all those pattern bags. You know, the patterns come in bags, and of course, I've got hundreds of these because I write patterns and put them in bags, but you might have a storage place where you keep plastic bags. If not, Ziploc bags work just fine. And I love to recycle these and reuse these over and over and over again. So what I did is I created a bag for every color on my color chart. So let me share the color chart with you. And the color chart right here is indicating the colors that I'm using for the different temperatures. Now, my temperatures have all been in the 31 to 40, 41 to 50, and 21 to 30 range. So between 20, 30, and 40, and 50 degrees. That's where everything has been so far. So I haven't yet gotten up to 51 to 60, but I know that's probably gonna happen this weekend. So I've been slowly going through my fabrics and pulling out anything that looks like these colors. Then I wanna show you how I'm getting them organized. So I'm pulling out anything that has those colors. So I've got a big bin here just from my scrap pile of anything with that green. I do have a couple of yellows in here too because I got some temperatures in the yellow range, but I wanted to stick to getting my greens prepared. So I took out this plastic bin and I cut a little bit off of every green fabric that I had in my stash. Now, a good rule of thumb is to do a 5x7 piece. The 5x7 piece will give you a 4-inch square and a 3-inch circle. That way you know you've used this fabric in two different ways in your temperature quilt. Now, I'm gonna give you a little hint. I'm so pleased that my mom has decided to do the temperature quilt this year. She's gonna make this, oh, it's a special secret. So I can't tell you who it's for or where she's doing her temperatures, but she was worried she didn't have enough fabric because she's downsized, right? And I got most of her fabric stash. So I decided that as I go through my fabrics, I'm not gonna cut one 5x7 piece. It's just as easy to cut two 5x7 pieces, and I can put one in mom's pile and one in my pile. Now, wouldn't that be amazing if your friend, who knew you were gonna do a temperature quilt too, gifted you with a whole stack of 5x7 pieces of fabric so that you could do the temperature quilt together. What a great idea. So pair up with a friend, cut 5x7, two 5x7 pieces from all of your fabrics, and then exchange them. This is how you're going to make this into not only a temperature quilt, but this could be a charm quilt for you. You could have every different piece of fabric that is different. So if you have a green bin, go through your green bin, pull out anything that's lime green, cut two 5x7 pieces, and you are ready to go. I didn't think of that ahead of time, so I only cut one 5x7 piece, but I haven't put my greens away yet, so I'm gonna continue to do that. And then from there, I'm going to start cutting my 4-inch squares. So here I have a few 4-inch squares already cut from my lime green fabrics. And then I went through my stash again. Do you have a box for fused fabric? I know I keep this box for fused fabric right on my sewing table so that if I end up with leftover small pieces of fused fabric, this one's pretty big, but usually the small pieces of fused fabric end up in here, like this one. Then I can take all of those pieces and I can cut those into my 3-inch squares. Now, I'm not cutting 3-inch squares. I'm not cutting 3-inch circles. I'm cutting 2.5-inch circles using my Hearts and More template B. So I'm cutting 2.5-inch circles, and if I have a fused fabric already, I'm getting those ready into my 2.5-inch circles. If the fabric is not fused, you can absolutely put a little scrap of fusible on the back of your square and then cut it into a 2.5-inch circle. But this is how I'm getting organized. I am making a little plastic bag for each one of these colors. And let me take out my green plastic bag here. And now I'm gonna take those fabrics that I've already cut and I'm gonna slide the 4-inch squares into that plastic bag. And if you stack them up one on top of the other, they'll stay nice and flat inside that plastic bag. And I'm gonna add my little circles. Well, I've used a whole bunch of these over the last few days, and that's only 1 week. I know I'm probably gonna use 30, 40, or 50 of each, the squares and the circles, so I can get those ready. I can get those ready ahead of time. And then it'll make every day easier as I go through this project. Then on the outside of the bag with an indelible marker, I'm gonna write the temperature range. So I haven't gotten this done yet. But as I said, this is our time to work together. I'm gonna be working on my projects as you're working on your projects. And I'm gonna be sharing with you how I do things, how I get organized, how I cut those circles, etc. So last time I showed you how to cut the circles. And this time I'm showing you how to get them all organized. That way I can keep all of these bags in order right here. I put a little clip on them, that way they stay in order. And then I've got a little box that's gonna live on my table for the next year. Inside that box, I'm gonna put my template for the 2.5-inch circle right there. And then I'm gonna put my template for cutting those 4-inch squares. I'm using this template, which is a Tucker trimmer, because it's got a nice diagonal line and it's got those even numbers, the 4-inch. And then if you turn it around, it's got the odd numbers, the 2.5, 3.5, and 4.5 inches, because I'm cutting my squares at 4.5, but I'm gonna square them up to 3.5 before I stitch them together into the quilt. Now there are two different size, actually there's 4 different size quilts in that pattern. You can make your temperature quilt with 4-inch squares, or that would finish at 3.5. Or you can cut them down to 3.5 inches, that would finish at 3 inches in the quilt, and that's the one that I'm gonna do. Okay, a Facebook user says, while I'm not interested in making a temperature quilt, my grandson is very into shapes, so I'm thinking about using this pattern and making an I Spy quilt with it for him. I love that idea. So you could absolutely use this pattern for an I Spy quilt. You can use it for a scrap quilt. You can use it for a charm quilt. The I Spy is super cute because in those circles, you can put all different little things that your child would be interested in. Think of all the little 2.5-inch motifs you can find in fabric. You can do cowboy boots. You can do cats and dogs. You can do nurses and doctors. You can do Pokemon. You can do all kinds of things in that I Spy quilt, and that would be a fabulous idea. So thank you for sharing that. That's wonderful. Somebody just came on and they said they forget that I'm in Easter time and they're in Eastern time and they're in Central time, so they got on late. But so good that you are here. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. They got the New Life Ministries charity in the comments. Okay, I think that we've got all of the questions answered, so I will continue on. Excellent. Now you're gonna see that up on my wall, I have a bright rainbow fabric, and it truly is a rainbow. And it looks beautiful with all of these fabrics. I had a feeling it would. So I picked up a yard of that fabric at Hancock's of Paducah. Hancock's of Paducah is one of my favorite mail order catalogs for fabric. So you can get fabric from them. It gets out to you in no time at all. The problem with buying fabric online is that you cannot see the colors very well. But I had a feeling that that stripe was going to be great, and I'm going to use that stripe either as a small border in my quilt. There is a small border in the quilt, whoops, right here. So I'm either going to use that as the small border, which I think would be fabulous, bringing all those colors together, or I'm going to use it as that half inch binding. And if I use it as the binding, I'll probably put it on the bias. So that'll be super fun. So there's the pattern, and I'm currently making my quilt. So there's no actual quilt photo on the pattern, Beth Helfter made it, but hers is slightly different. She didn't put borders. So I used the file from EQ on the cover, and then that will be replaced by my quilt once my quilt is done. Okay, so that's enough about the temperature quilt, because we've been talking about that a lot, but it's super important to me, because what's my goal? I want to make a difference while I make my living. So I think that this is a great way to support this charity and to get involved in what I do, so that you can see how much fun this applique process is and how easy it is. All right, let's talk about those UFOs. I don't think I've seen any UFO names in the chat. I see WIP. What does that mean? Work in progress, right? So don't only put the acronym, put what it means as well, because I know there's a million of them out there. So I see Kathy out there. I see Jen and Bev and a couple of Facebook users, and I don't know your name. Oh, it's Darlene in Connecticut. Okay, good. So go ahead and put what a UFO, what your acronym is for a UFO. I'm going to put in PIGS because I think that is great. So projects in grocery sacks. Sacks, I can't spell right, is PIGS. So let me know different acronyms for UFOs. So let me tell you about the UFO challenge that I'm going to run. Most of you already know about it, those people that I'm seeing in the comments. But if you're not in my Ahead of the Curve membership, I just want to let you know that I'm running a little UFO challenge for those members. Because we have our own private Facebook group, what I'm going to have you do, I'm going to give you a list or a form to fill out your top 12 UFOs. Now, you might only have two or three or four. If you do, you can spread them out throughout the year on this calendar that I'm going to give you. So every month, you could put in a different UFO that you want to get finished. If your goal is to finish one of those pigs this month, go ahead and work on that during our sit and sew or during these Facebook Lives. If you consistently work on that project a little bit every day, maybe 23 minutes every day during 2023, you're going to get those works in progress done. So when you finish your work in progress, you're going to post a picture of that UFO on our Facebook group. That's the Ahead of the Curve private Facebook group. Then I'll be monitoring that Facebook group. I'll put your name in a drawing if you get your WIPs done, your works in progress done. You'll get one entry if it's a non-SPD project. In fact, in other words, if you didn't start this project in a Sue Pellin Designs workshop, if it's not a Sue Pellin Designs project, I still want you to get it done because that's going to free you up to do more applique. So absolutely submit any UFO that you have. If it is a Sue Pellin Designs project, if you started it in a workshop or in a course with me, or maybe you started it all on your own with the pattern, go ahead and finish your Sue Pellin Designs projects and you'll get two entries into the drawing. We're going to have quarterly drawings, and I found some really fabulous prizes as I was perusing my distributor's website this week. So I have some fabulous prizes in mind and on order for you, and we're going to have a drawing each quarter. Now, you know me, I love to give stuff away, so who knows if it's going to be quarterly, or maybe we'll do a first and a second place. Who knows? We'll think about that, but I'm making sure that I'm finding some really interesting notions or other helpful things for around your sewing room that will go into our prize packages. WWTSTB, what is that supposed to be? I love it. Work in a basket, Ellie, that's a great one. WWIT, what was I thinking? Ah, oh, that's fabulous. So good, good, good. We've got lots of names for our UFOs. We're going to probably call it a UFO challenge, but maybe I will take another peek at that name and see if we want to rename that into something else. Along with that UFO challenge, I promise you, I'm going to give you a list of all of these great UFO names. I think that's just adorable. Okay, so what about... Oh, I know what I was going to do. I was going to talk about quilting before applique. So I have a project. I didn't bring that project in with me, but I'm going to be able to share my screen. Let's share my screen. And I'm going to be able to, on that screen, let's see if I can get it on working first before I go into it. So I'm going to be able to share on that screen my Sue Pellin Designs website. Okay, so let's share that. And on that website, it's going to tell you that you can join us for applique school, and you can register right here for January 11th, 12th, and 13th. So that is this Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Now, many of you that I see on these comments, you're already members of Ahead of the Curve. But if you want to come, I love it when you give testimony to the fact that you're enjoying the membership and all the other programs here at Sue Pellin Design. So feel free to come. But this is really geared towards the newbies, people that do not know yet about rotary cut applique and how we can make your life more fun, more creative, and more productive using rotary cut applique. So you can sign in right there and register for applique school. But I want to talk to you about our events. So let's look at our events for January. For February. One of our events for February, here we go, is a quilt that I call Quilt As You Go Trees. I wasn't very creative with my name, but this Quilt As You Go Trees pattern is so, so pretty. I just love this tree pattern. And I wasn't really thrilled with my background fabrics that I made for that tree pattern. So this morning I went looking in my stash to see what other kind of fabric I could use to go behind those trees. And I was thinking maybe something like a nice sky. This is kind of a batik that reminds me of the sky. Maybe a sunset, right? It's got all those different pinks and greens and yellows in it. It almost looks like birds if you look really close up to that batik pattern. So maybe that might be a really good background for my trees. The fabric I was looking for, couldn't find it. I was looking for a cityscape fabric that I have. I know I have it. It's all tall buildings for New York City. And I really would love to find that fabric because I would really like to do this pattern again. And what it reminds me of is trees in the city. So I would love to do trees in front of that cityscape. And a place that's near and dear to my heart is Central Park in New York City. We go to Central Park frequently. We love to play football in Central Park. We love to just walk around and go to the beautiful, beautiful gardens there. The tulip garden is spectacular. Strawberry Fields is one of my favorite places. So I would like to make my Quilt As You Go trees represent Central Park in New York City. So I'm looking for this fabric that looks like buildings in the background, and then I'm going to put my trees in the foreground. But why is this quilt called Quilt As You Go Trees? Well, one of the things that we can do is we can pre-quilt our background fabric. So not the trunks, not the branches, not the leaves. We can pre-quilt the background fabric as one piece, and then we can divide that fabric up into the four sections that you see as the background, those four sections. And then we can decorate each section with the branches and the leaves, and then we're going to pull it all together in a quilt-as-you-go technique designed by Pauline Rogers. And the point of this project is to teach you that quilt as you go technique. We don't have time in a 4-hour workshop to do our quilting. So the quilting needs to be done ahead of time if you're going to make this a quilt as you go project. So I just wanted to point that out to all of my members that if you are taking the quilt as you go trees, you got some homework to do before February. And that's why I'm mentioning it now. It is in your supply list and your student supplement. It talks to you about getting your quilting done first. But I wanted to reiterate that for all of the members that are here with me on Sewing in Slippers with Sue. Again, if you're not a member and this quilt looks really intriguing to you, you could join the membership in any time in January and this could be your February workshop. Now, this is a level one workshop. Oh my gosh, really? A level one workshop and I'm going to be doing quilt as you go and applique? Ugh. Well, you know, it's a level one workshop as far as the applique goes. The quilt as you go is probably a more advanced skill than most people are used to doing, but anybody can do this. I can absolutely let you know that we have had beginners do these types of projects. Now, I'm not going to say beginners to a sewing machine. That's not realistic, right? But if you're a confident sewer and if you're a confident beginner, you can do these level one workshops, okay? Another level one workshop that we're offering is an Almost Baltimore class. So let me just go back here, see if I can get back to the calendar. And our Almost Baltimore block for February is this beautiful paisley heart. Now, once again, this is a level one or two class. You can make this Baltimore plain or fancy, and we're going to be learning some really fun techniques to make this an easier block. So I just thought I would point that out and let you know what's coming down the pike. But I also want to let you know a couple of different things. We have a special guest coming on to Sewing in Slippers, both in January and in February. I'll talk about the February guest first because she's a dear friend of mine. She's Joan Ford from Hummingbird Highway. And if you love birds, you're going to want to learn about Joan. So come join Joan and I on the 21st of February. Then, if you look back to January, we have another very special guest coming next week to Sewing in Slippers with Sue. So, next week we have Roy. It's not up there. I'm surprised. Oh, there it is. There it is. Okay. On the 17th, we have our special guest, Roy Mitchell Jr., and he will be joining us for Sewing in Slippers next Tuesday at 11. I met Roy at a quilt show, and you are going to be just blown away by his story and what he does for a living. Talk about making a difference while making a living. His job is an amazing service, and I want you all to hear about what Roy is doing in his position as a quilting teacher. So Roy's going to join us. He is delightful. You're going to be entertained. We're going to have some fun, and I can't wait to see Roy's own quilts. I've seen his students' quilts, but I cannot wait to see Roy's own quilts. You will find him on social media as Watermelon Man, and he will tell you all about that next Tuesday at 11. Okay, so getting back to the February project. That February project, you're going to want to get your fabrics ready for quilting. If you're not sure how to do that, we do have a quilting segment in our technique videos. It talks about basting with Misty Fuse and getting your overall quilting done. Your quilting doesn't have to be fancy or spectacular for this quilt. You can use a really busy background and just get it quilted. Now, I've been learning about some new quilters, and I tell you, this morning, I enrolled in a machine quilting course by a woman from Australia. I am not going to name her just yet. I'm not going to tell you about the course until I have taken that course myself, but my very good friend and student, Wendy Morrison, took this course and fell in love with it. It brought her to her next level of quilting ability. The beginner course she did with Renee Merrill. On my suggestion, she took Renee's course, and that was a wonderful course for her. Let me stop sharing. So she started with Renee Merrill's course, and that was the perfect beginning for a novice quilter to start machine quilting. But then she needed the next step up to actually learn loads of different patterns. And that's where she took this second course that I enrolled in this morning. So I can't wait to improve my machine quilting skills with another course so that I can continue to help you improve your skills as well. So we also do some machine quilting in our membership. Does your definition of finished mean finished top or quilted, labeled, and bound? Quilted, labeled, and bound, Elaine. It's not a quilt until it's quilted. So my definition is quilted, labeled, and bound. Now, you could have a different definition. Your works in progress could be finished when the top is done. But in order to get into the drawings, I'm going to say quilted, labeled, and bound. Off of your brain, off of your work table, out of your sewing room, and ready for gifting, ready for hanging. Okay? All right, excellent. So our next Sewing in Slippers with Sue is with Roy Mitchell. You're going to have so much fun with Roy. I can't wait to interview him. And then we have a special guest just about once a month. Now, we also do a member spotlight, and we try to do that once a month. So if you're not camera shy and you are one of my Ahead of the Curve members, I'd like to invite you onto Sewing in Slippers as well. Okay, so if I can't figure out, let me see. Oh, I found it. I wanted to get back to organizing your fabrics, and I was afraid I wasn't going to be able to do that because I was having a hard time changing my camera. But now I figured it out. I learned how to change my camera. So I want to work with these black fabrics and just show you briefly how I'm going to get organized for my temperature quilt. So this morning I rummaged through my black fabric pile, and I decided that since my quilt is going to be so colorful, I didn't want to use just any black fabric. Now, my black fabric is only going to come into play when my temperature is 100 plus, but I didn't want to use just any black fabric. I wanted to use black fabrics that had some life to them, some color to them. So I chose just a couple, because I'm hoping that we're not going to get 100 plus very often this upcoming year. But I am going to take my black fabrics and I'm going to layer them a few at a time. And I'm going to make sure the color is what I'm going for. Right here, this is multicolor. But under here, if I take this section, it's just black and yellow. So I'm going to move over here where it's black, yellow, pink, and blue. And I'm going to cut my 5x7 piece of each one of these fabrics so that I can share with a friend. So I'm creating a collection of charms that I can share with a friend or share with my mom. Now, in this case, because I'm cutting my yardage into pieces, I'm going to use my 45 millimeter rotary cutter. But normally I don't do that. I normally work with a 28 millimeter rotary cutter. But to make things go fast and to not dull my blades of my 28 millimeter rotary cutter, I'm going to use this big 45. So I'm cutting 5x7, and then I'm going to create a pile for me and a pile for my mom. So here we go, is one for me and one for mom. I've got one for me and one for mom. Now I know that this is so basic and kind of simple. So I hope that you're working on your projects along with me. I don't want you to just sit here and watch me cut 5 by 7-inch rectangles. You know how to do all that. But if I do something kind of a little bit simple, then you can work right along with me and you can get your projects done too. Now, if I do have a fabric like this that's been in storage and it needs to be pressed, go ahead and press that before you start cutting your 4-inch squares. Now, you could immediately cut 3.5-inch squares, and that would be perfectly fine. If you want to cut your 3.5-inch squares, and then you're going to applique your circles on top, you will be fine. But I know that in pressing and in stitching and just handling these squares, they might get slightly distorted. So I'm going to cut 4-inch squares. I'm going to put a 2.5-inch circle on each of those squares once I know the temperatures. And then I'm going to blanket stitch. Once I do all of that, and then I press it, it might be distorted. I'm going to be able to re-square that to 3.5, and it's going to finish up at 3. Now I've got these leftover pieces from my 5x7. I'm going to trim those down to 3 inches. And then I'm going to fuse the back of those 3-inch pieces so that I can cut out my 2.5-inch circles. Now this one was already fused. It was in my bucket, and I saw that it was already fused, so I might as well cut my 2.5-inch circle already out of that fabric. If I have more than 2 days, 3 days that are in the 100-plus high temperature, I'll be surprised. Quite honestly, I don't expect that I will ever use these 4-inch squares, because that would be the low temperature that day, being 100-plus. That's never going to happen, really, here in New England. But I like to be prepared, and I just wanted to show you that we do have our fabrics all prepared and ready to go, even for the worst temperatures. So I'm not going to cut any more than that. More than likely, I won't even use these blacks, but that lets me get to the next color in the line. Now, I've been using a lot of this color, the green, and I know that I'm going to be, my next temperatures are either going to be colder or warmer. So instead of going right up to that black and then going back to the purple and starting to get prepared with my purples, why not do the temperatures that are right around what I'm currently getting? So I'm going to pull out my, I think I'll even go with the turquoise. We are likely to get some temperatures between 11 and 20. So I'm going to pull out my turquoise. I'm going to pull out the green, 21 to 30. I already have my lime green, and I'm going to pull out my yellow and orange. There's nothing else that I really need right now, so I'm going to put these others, I'm going to clip them and put them aside, and I'm going to focus on just these colors. So my first go through my scrap bin was all my green fabrics. I'm going to work on, first of all, I'm going to find anything that's fused and cut my circles from the fused fabric. Then I'm going to go through anything that's not fused and cut my 4-inch squares. And if I don't have it fused already, I'll probably cut a 3-inch square, fuse that up, and get it all ready for my quilt. Now here's a little square that's already fused. I'm going to start cutting those 2.5-inch circles. Once I have cut my 4-inch square and my 2.5-inch circle, and they go right here into this Ziploc bag, I can put all of this back in my stash. This is all going to go back into my green bin, and then I'm going to pull out my next color. I'll go back to that green bin, and I'll pull out the darker greens, and I'll get this one done next. Then if I have any more time this week, I'll go to my turquoise bin, pull out anything that's turquoise, and go through this whole process again. So this is what's going to make the temperature quilt really faster and easier is being all prepared with that job of going through your fabric. And as you do go through that fabric, you're going to be able to get organized, and you're going to know that your stash has been, your stash is all going to contribute into that scrap quilt. And while you're at it, go ahead and make a scrap pile for a friend as well. All right, let me come back to you on the camera. I'm gonna change my camera back to my head on camera. I got my coffee here. Most of you know that I am a real coffee fanatic. And if you want to keep in touch with what Supellin Designs is doing, if you want to know all of the things that are happening in the Supellin Designs applique world, you're going to want to sign up for the Applique Cafe. If you go onto my website, supellindesigns.com, and we left that website URL for you right in the comments. But if you go here to supellindesigns.com and you go to my home page, right? Let me share that. If you go right here to my home page and you're not on my email list, go ahead and click on Get a Free Pattern. When you click on Get a Free Pattern, it is going to add you to my Applique Cafe newsletter. And at the same time, you'll get a pattern for the mini quilt, the mug rug. I thought I had those. Oh, here they are, right here. So it is the little mini pin quilt right here, the mug rug, and our coaster pattern. So all three of those are orange peel patterns. They're all made. You can make one of these while you take the free mini workshop, and you will get the pattern for all of those when you sign up for the newsletter. So go ahead at supellindesigns.com, click on the home page, and over here it says Get a Free Pattern. That's where you can subscribe. In the meantime, if you want to join us for applique school and learn three different methods of applique, go ahead and sign up in the pink or purple box up here at the top of the screen. When you click on that to register, you're going to just fill in your name, your email, press the submit button, and you will have the free pros and cons worksheet delivered to you in your inbox. That's the worksheet that we're going to work through with all three different applique methods so that you can see what the pros and cons are of each applique method and see which one is right for you. All right, well, I'm going to call it a day a little bit early today because I have some really fun things that I'm working on. I want to get that UFO email out to my members. I want to talk about those pigs, those projects in grocery sacks. Bev Henyon. Ah, he's incredible. I'm assuming you're talking about Roy Mitchell. Roy Mitchell is incredible. So if you don't know about Watermelon Man yet, you're going to see him on next week. What is this supposed to be? Work in a basket. What was I thinking? All these different acronyms for the UFOs that we all have around our sewing room. I'm going to go get to work and get that email out to all of our members, how they're going to participate in our UFO challenge. Now, I am so thrilled that you are helping me make a living while making a difference. And if you want to join in our temperature quilt group, you can join the temperature quilt Facebook group, and you can get your pattern right here at supellindesigns.com. The pattern is in What's New. So if you're not sure where to get the pattern for the scrappy happy circle quilt, you can get your pattern right at supellindesigns.com in the What's New section of the website, of the shop. So find out what's new, find your scrappy happy pattern, put it in your cart, and $21.95 will go right to the orphanage in Uganda. Thank you for helping me spread the word about that. Share it with your friends, with your quilt guild. Let's make this go viral, and we will raise more than enough to send these 30 kids to school. I want to send them to school for a year. My goal is half of their tuition. But we'll see what we can do. If we can provide their entire tuition, then we'll be able to start saving money for an actual orphanage building where they will be protected from mosquitoes, where we'll have mosquito netting over their beds. All of this is yet to come. It's a brand new project, and I am really pleased to be able to be part of this journey for these kids. And I'm just thrilled to be able to, in my little way, to help provide for these kids and make a difference in their life. Well, thank you all for joining me today. I hope that you're going to go have some fun with applique today. If you want to keep in touch, absolutely get on the newsletter list, and that's the best way for us to keep in touch. And come next week for Sewing in Slippers with Sue, where I will have my guest Roy Mitchell tell us all about his mission and his way of making a difference in the world through his work. All right, everybody, have a wonderful day. Go get those works in progress done, and we can get you on the list for a special prize. Bye, everybody.